Thus was the young and tender-hearted prince brought to the knowledge of all these beggars, and therefore it was that their condition filled him with sadness and induced him to speak so boldly to the king his father. When he returned to Borland with the tidings that the king had granted him permission to rule for a day the kingdom, the tutor was overjoyed, and at once they began to plan ways for relieving all the poor of the country in that one day. For one thing, they dispatched private messengers to every part of the kingdom, bidding them tell each beggar they met to come to the prince on that one day he should be king, and he would relieve their wants, giving a broad gold piece to every poor man or woman who asked. For the prince had determined to devote to this purpose the gold that filled the royal coffers, and as for the great ball and tourney the king had planned, why, that could go begging much better than the starving people. On the night before the day the prince was to reign, there was a great confusion of noise within the city, for beggars from all parts of the kingdom began to arrive, each one filled with joy at the prospect of receiving a piece of gold. There was a continual tramp, tramp of feet, and a great barking of dogs, as all dogs in those days were trained to bark at every beggar they saw, and now it was difficult to restrain them. And the beggars came to town singly and by twos and threes, until hundreds were there to await the morrow. Some few were very pitiful to behold, being feeble and infirm from age and disease, dressed in rags and tags, and presenting an appearance of great distress. But there were many more who were seemingly hearty and vigorous, and these were the lazy ones who, not being willing to work, begged for a livelihood. And some there were dressed in silken hose and velvet gowns, who, forgetting all shame and eager for gold, had been led by the prince's offer to represent themselves as beggars, that they might add to their wealth without trouble or cost to themselves. The next morning when the sun arose upon the eventful day, it found the prince sitting upon the throne of his father, dressed in a robe of ermine and purple, a crown upon his flowing locks, and the king's scepter clasped tightly in his little hand. He was somewhat frightened at the clamor of the crowd without the palace, but Borland, who stood behind him, whispered, "The more you can succor, the greater will be your glory, and you will live in the hearts of your people as the kind prince who relieved their sufferings. Be of good cheer, your majesty, for all is well." Then did the prince command the treasurer to bring before him the royal coffers, and to stand ready to present to each beggar a piece of gold. The treasurer was very unwilling to do this, but he was under penalty of death if he refused, and so the coffers were brought forth. "Your majesty," said the treasurer, "if each of those who clamor without is to receive a piece of gold, there will not be enough within these coffers to go around. Some will receive, and others will be denied, since no further store of gold is to be had." At this news the prince was both puzzled and alarmed. "What are we to do?" he asked of the tutor, but Borland was unable to suggest a remedy. Then said the aged chamberlain, coming forward and bowing low before the little king, "Your majesty, I think I can assist you in your difficulty. You did but promise a piece of gold to those who are really suffering and in need, but so great is the greed of mankind that many without are in no necessity whatever, but only seek to enrich themselves at your expense. Therefore I propose you examine carefully each case that presents itself, and unless the beggar is in need of alms, turn him away empty-handed, as being a fraud and a charlatan." "Your counsel is wise, O chamberlain," replied the prince after a moment's thought, "and by turning away the impostors we shall have gold enough for the needy. Therefore bid the guards to admit the beggars one by one." When the first beggar came before him, the prince asked, "Are you in need?"
"I am starving, your majesty,"
replied the man in a whining tone. He was poorly dressed, but seemed strong and well, and the prince examined him carefully for a moment. Then he answered the fellow, saying, "Since you are starving, go and sell the gold ring I see you are wearing upon your finger. I can assist only those who are unable to help themselves." At this, the man turned away muttering angrily, and the courtiers murmured their approval of the prince's wisdom. The next beggar was dressed in velvet, and the prince sent him away with a sharp rebuke. But the third was a woman, old and feeble, and she blessed the prince as she hobbled joyfully away with a broad gold piece clasped tightly within her withered hand. The next told so pitiful a story that he also received a gold piece, but as he turned away, the prince saw that beneath his robe his shoes were fastened with silver buckles, and so he commanded the guards to take away the gold and to punish the man for attempting to deceive his king.